Ave Maria, today we are having a very good discussion and we are going to talk about demonic activity or influence in human beings. Now, first thing you must understand is that a demon or an evil spirit to have any influence on a person, there must be an open door where they pass. And this open door is mainly a sin, especially a mortal sin. Now, demons are not like COVID-19. You can't be moving around and a demon enters you. A demon, to get any influence over a human being, must first get permission from God. And we see that from the story of Job in the Old Testament, where the devil had to ask for permission to torture Job. We also see it in the New Testament, where the demoniac who was freed by Jesus, and then the demons asked Jesus for permission to go into pigs. Now, when most people read that story, they conclude that pigs are not good for eating because demons went into pigs. But that was not the intention of the gospel. The reason was to let you know, because at the time, the Jews considered pigs to be very disgusting animals. They are the worst. So the gospel writer wanted to show you that even when demons want to enter into something as low as pigs, they first ask for permission from God. And that is why they had to ask Jesus for permission and he had to allow them before they could enter those pigs. That's the story. Now, there are four stages of demonic influence. And this is according to Father Gabriel Amoth. He passed on. He was the chief exorcist of the Vatican. So the first stage is called infestation. And in infestation, demons do not attack people directly. They can attack property, they can attack furniture, they can even attack animals. So that is what happens when you hear maybe doors banging or you hear footsteps or something like that. That is demonic infestation. The next stage is called demonic oppression. And this includes stuff like physical attacks, sleep disturbances, you might get nightmares, severe or frequent illnesses, relationship problems, financial problems. And most of these normally either come at once or in rapid succession. So when you see those, you can think there is demonic oppression, you might suspect. The third stage is called oppression. And in oppression, the person has a hard time functioning. There is constant preoccupation with thoughts of demonic activity, and there is normally suicidal thoughts. When somebody normally wants to commit suicide, it could be a sign of demonic obsession. And the last and most dangerous stage is called possession, demonic possession. This is where a person is physically, emotionally, mentally, or spiritually broken down, so that demonic spirits can seize occasional control over a person's actions. But you must remember that even in possession, demons can never take over your intellect or will. Those are the higher echelons of the human soul, which the devil can never have access. So even if you're possessed, your intellect and will are still free. You cannot blame your actions on the demons. Now that we have gone through the different stages of demonic influence, I'm going to take you through what normally causes these things, especially the last stage, demonic possession. So, number one, I'll talk about consulting a witch doctor. Now, when you go to any person, whether it's a witch doctor or medicine person, but they are using evil spirits, for example, you go to a witch doctor and maybe somebody has stolen your goat and you say, can you help me recover my goat? Or somebody is stealing my bananas in the plantation. So this person will give you like some medicine and say, go and plant this in your plantation. The thieves are not coming again. Now, what you do not know is that this medicine has come with some demons. And these demons are going to remain in your family for at least 4 generations. And this might be prolonged when there is a sin like abortion in the family or murder. So please be careful. Do not go to witch doctors. The medicine they give you has demons, and these demons are going to not only affect you, but also your children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren. That's how bad it is. Next, I'm going to talk about bedroom aunties. This is common with the Baganda, you know that. For example, a lady is going to get married. So they are going to give you, they call them singers, an auntie, to teach you how to keep your sexual life in order. Now, whatever she tells you normally brings lust demons into your marriage. That's why these marriages never last. Then I'm going to talk about rainmakers. You have a wedding. This is very common. I'm sure you know about these things. You have a wedding and you fear that it's going to rain and spoil the party. So you hire somebody to come and stop the rain. Or a burial, you hire somebody to come and stop the rain. Now, which power do these people use to stop the rain? Because they do not pray. They use fallen angels. When you look through the hierarchy of angels, there are 9 choirs. There are some hierarchies which are in charge of controlling the weather. Now remember, when the angels fell, they were from different choirs. So some of the fallen angels were from that choir which controls climate and weather of the earth. And remember, these fallen angels did not lose their powers. They are still as powerful. So that is what these people use. So when you have a wedding and you call somebody to stop the rain, you are from church, just know that God is no longer in your marriage. You have introduced demons, and they are the ones going to take over from that point on. So please, when you have a wedding, when you have a function, do not call anybody to stop the rain. You can pray about it and let God's will be done. If God wants it to rain on your function, let it be. It's better than you having demons in your family for 4 generations because you wanted a good wedding. I'm going to talk about rituals and ceremonies which they perform at burials. Most of you know these things. When a car is going to take a coffin carrying a dead body, some people will put eggs so that the tires of the car step on the eggs. Those are some of the things which can bring demonic influence in your family. Then there are rituals also which widows do, so that there is this fear that when a man dies, he's going to come back to have sex with the widow. Most of you people know these things. So they give you some medicine so that this man does not come back. Now, when you do that, you have gotten involved in two demonic influence. You're going to have demons running your family for generations and generations. Another thing you might be familiar with but not know that it is dangerous is reading the horoscope. The horoscope is forbidden. So following those things might also bring about demonic possession or infestation or something like that. Then there's also yoga. What most people don't understand is that yoga is a form of religious meditation. It is like the opposite of the rosary. When we are praying the rosary, we are meditating on the mysteries of Christ. So you might think that yoga is an activity, a physical activity meant to calm you down, but in fact, it originated from the eastern regions, and it is a religious activity. It is not a physical activity. So please, if you have been doing yoga, you need to go for confession. You need to stop that and protect yourself. Serious mortal sins. A mortal sin is a sin which you know is bad, but you go ahead and do it. You do it willingly and without external influence, and yet you know that it is bad. So some serious mortal sins can bring demonic influence over you. especially things like abortion and sexual perversion, like homosexuality, having orgies. Some of the things can do that. The last one I'm going to talk about is submitting yourself to the authority of religious leaders who are fake, so that they put hands on you in prayer. Now that we have gotten through what can cause demonic influence over your life, I'm going to take you through what you can do now that you know to overcome all this. Number one is the sacrament of confession. If you have done or taken part in some of the things I've said, please go for confession and confess that sin and promise God not to do it again. The confessional box is the number one exorcism place. That's the best place where you can be free from demonic activity. Then there is the Eucharist and the other sacraments, because they confer grace on you. There is Mass, when you attend Mass with a devotion, praying the Rosary and wearing the scapular. The Rosary is a very powerful prayer, and you know that.